Well, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. This afternoon, we have the pleasure of having Dr. Platanias join us. Let me just give you a little bit of background about him. I'm sure many of you are very familiar with him, but as you see here, he's the Lurie Family Professor of Oncology at Northwestern University and has been in that role since 2002. More recently, he also assumed the role of the interim director of the Robert H. Lurie Comprehensive Cancer Center at Northwestern. He graduated with an MD and a PhD from the University of Patras in Greece, did training at the as a Fogarty Fellow at the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, followed by an internal medicine residency at Downstate, Hemonc Fellowship at University of Illinois, and his first faculty positions were at the U of I, where he rose to the level of professor before being recruited to Northwestern. He has a very distinguished investigative career, has had a major national presence, and it really gives me great pleasure to welcome you to Ann Arbor, and we look forward to hearing your vision. So welcome.
Thank you very much for the introduction. It is a real pleasure to be here. And I have to say that this cancer center is the University of Michigan Cancer Center is a remarkable place under the leadership of Max Wita. There have been remarkable achievements here. So it is a true honor to be considered for this position. So what I will try to do first is to turn this on. Okay. So what I will try to do is go over a few things that I consider important for a cancer center. And I have a talk that is about 40, 45 minutes long, and then there will be time for discussion, obviously. But I will just give an overview about my views about cancer centers and what's happening these days. Then I will talk about research and try to focus it here in Michigan, the clinical operations and the potential of this place, education and philanthropy, which I think are the important elements for any cancer center. So we live in very interesting times these days. There have been remarkable advances in clinical research and cancer care. And these are a few examples that I have listed here: cancer genomics, precision medicine, molecularly targeted therapies, cancer stem cells, new imaging technologies, nanotechnology, and it keeps going. We live in a remarkable era. At the same time, there have been issues and challenges broadly to the field. There are still limitations in outcomes. There are cancer health disparities. There is decreasing funding, federal funding for research. There are issues with survivorship, comorbidities, and importantly, financial challenges in cancer care. So now cancer centers have a mission, and that is to promote cancer research, to provide multidisciplinary state-of-the-art treatment, to have clinical programs with access to experimental treatments, to train scientists and physicians in cancer, relating to cancer, and also public education and outreach. And that's what really the comprehensive cancer centers do these days. Now, there is a group of, as I call them, leading cancer centers that are the ones who define research trends, transform clinical practice in oncology, and impact cancer prevention, and facilitate the dissemination of new treatments to the community. And undoubtedly, the University of Michigan Cancer Center is one of them. So, talking about the future of this place, obviously the goal of any new director here should be to continue advancing the cancer center as a global leader in cancer research, treatment, prevention, and education. And to do things, I think there are two key objectives. One is to take research and clinical operations to the next level. And the second one is to expand the national reach and international presence and prominence of this place. Here is, I took that recently from the website of NIH, and if someone ranks the cancer centers based on funding, including the comprehensive cancer centers, Michigan is obviously ranked very highly, and there is a group of cancer centers here that they are all together. So it's between 5 and 7 positions, and if someone looks at the Matrix Cancer Center in 2013, it's number 2. So the place is really very high up in science, and there is remarkable funding and achievements, because major achievements have taken place here. So as someone looks for the future of this, of what should happen next, should also keep in mind what NCI is thinking. And this slide is from the presentation of Harold Varmus in this March, at Frederick, I was there. It was a presentation to cancer center directors. And the NCI is considering changing the way they fund cancer centers. And again, if someone is thinking to expand the place and develop new things, they should keep that in mind. They will decrease the base funding for each cancer center based on their status and not on the previous budget period. And that will be 50% of funding. And then they have a formula that they incorporate 30% for merit, 15% for the size of the cancer center, and 5% will be supplements. So there will be a lot of supplements, competitive supplements, so there should be a rapid response unit to move, you know, when this will be announced. So this will change the way cancer centers are funded, but it should not really affect in a negative way a place like this, because at least the merit funding should remain very high. So just trying to assess the situation here, and again, if I have something wrong, forgive me in advance. This is with the information I had. But I tried to put together a list of the strengths of the cancer center here in Michigan and the challenges. So there are many strengths here. This is a remarkable place. It is ranked 7th among all cancer centers, comprehensive cancer centers, and 2nd among matrix cancer centers. There is undoubtedly outstanding basic science research here. There are strong translational programs, outstanding clinical investigators, outstanding superb population science research, excellent research cores, and of course you have the MI OncoSeq, which is a big deal. There is, you know, the place is really advanced in terms of precision medicine just by having the OncoSeq. There is very strong cancer stem cell research. The clinical operations are excellent. And there is a strong tradition and national perception of excellence. This place is ranked highly among other cancer center directors. Now, challenges, there are some challenges like the NIH budget that affect all cancer centers. Space is usually a problem in many cancer centers. And there may be some more local challenges like accrual in clinical trials. And of course, there is always the local competition and the national competition. And maybe a unique challenge here is that this is not a travel hub. So if someone wants to expand the clinical operations in a major way at the national level should keep that in mind. So there are some potential areas for improvement. One is clinical research and enrollment in clinical trials, the need for more investigator-initiated trials, and again, as a place, one should think about expanding the clinical operations, having local and national networks, and defining the cancer center brand. Importantly, philanthropy, which in my opinion is an extremely important of the mission of any cancer center director, is another area that can one in any place can always improve. So here is a summary of what is the Cancer Center horizon here, the way I could see it with the information I had. But one, you know, can foresee this Cancer Center becoming really high, top one, two, three places, expand the reach from regional to national and international. The research, again, is outstanding. It could become, it is world-class already. The clinical trials, they can improve, go to become outstanding and maybe have more innovative investigator-initiated studies. And one could improve, of course, always have some improvement in the clinical operations, the quality, the patient experience, and, you know, increasing the markets there. So some preliminary perspectives that I have put together, and I'm going to go through some of them. For research, it will be extremely important to increase accrual in clinical trials. There should be some discussion about new developing and established programs in the Cancer Center grant. I will talk about considering new institutes, and I will explain what I mean by that, how I use the term institute. Maybe Department of Cancer Biology is something that many places are many medical schools are entertaining these days. There may be some clinical areas that can be strengthened more, like thoracic oncology and maybe GI malignancies beyond pancreas. And there could be some other issues that could help strengthening the clinical research, like mentoring of faculty and various other things that I will discuss in more detail. Now, about the clinical operations, again, the place is so strong. It has such a perception of excellence in precision medicine because of the MI OncoSeq that I believe someone should take advantage of that, use it to build the clinical brand of the Cancer Center around that. And, you know, of course, Kathy Cooney and the TV has been doing great efforts to expand the local network, and that should continue and expand more. But there should be also serious thought about developing a national network and an international place. This is a world-class place. The science here is really at a very high level, and if can someone address the rest of the issues, it could become a major international place. Now, about education, there are obviously things that any place should always consider, and with the developments in molecular medicine, precision medicine, updating the oncology curriculum, the way we train fellows and medical students will be important. The way oncology is practiced is changing rapidly, so it will be important to train these people in molecular medicine so they understand what we are discussing. And maybe, you know, in our cancer center, we have an associate director for education, and as the cancer center expands here, maybe that's one position that should be considered. Now, philanthropy, I'm going to discuss philanthropy at the end. I think it's extremely important, obviously, and I'm going to discuss some initiatives, strategies, and some concepts around industry partnerships that can help in that way. So I'm going to start going now through the various different steps, and I'm going to start with research, and I will start with basic science research, which again is very strong here. Right now, the basic science programs in the Cancer Center are listed here. I got that from the map that I received, and there are six very strong basic science programs that were reviewed very well in the last CCSG. They got a rank of excellent to outstanding, all of them, I think, from what I learned. And that's great. It is actually a little surprising because they deserve to be outstanding, but that's what happens with reviewers these days. But I'm sure in the next round they need to be ranked outstanding. So there are some issues that exist in all basic science programs in different cancer centers, and there may be some unique here. But clearly, enhancing intraprogrammatic interactions and promoting translation is important for the basic science research programs. And there may be some, for different programs, there may be a need to and hence the cancer focus and things like that. That's regular things that come up for any cancer center. One important philosophical issue that I have in general is that I believe that the leaders of the different programs should be empowered. They should have resources allocated to them. They should participate in the decisions of, and just be part of the whole process of the cancer center and not have all that done by the associate directors. So I think this is something that has major implications both for enhancing the strength of the programs, but also for philanthropy and other issues, and I will discuss that later. And I mentioned before that a Department of Cancer Biology is something that many medical schools are considering these days. At Northwestern, where I am, there is a commitment now for the dean to develop that. Now she has to find the money, of course. She's trying to raise the money to do that. So, looking at the programs as they are now, again, they are thematically very strong, and I think they are very well positioned for the next round. One could consider, you know, again, without knowing all the details, but if someone were to consider a new developing program, it could be signal transduction in cancer that links to therapeutics, targeted therapeutics. And again, there should be recruitments in the as needed in the next period to continue the growth and enhance these programs. And I put here, I mentioned the Department of Cancer Biology, and there are two programs in the basic sciences division, the experimental therapeutics and the tumor immunology and host response, that I included some interactions with potential new institutes. And I said I will define that later. But one could be the Developmental Therapeutics Institute, one could call it MIDTI, Michigan Developmental Therapeutics Institute, that works together with the Experimental Therapeutics Program, and another one, a Tumor Immunotherapy Institute that works with the Tumor Immunology and Host Response Program. Now moving to, and I will talk about that shortly, moving to translational and clinical research, I have put a list of areas that I think should be considered. I think one important thing if someone wants to improve accrual in clinical trials is to shorten the time from protocol submission to actual opening of the study, the time the first patient can enter the study. Optimally, I think it should be around 8 weeks. And we have been recently able to achieve that at Northwestern after, you know, a lot of effort over a 12-month period, and I think this is something that can happen here as well. Now, in terms of organization, one, there are several developing programs in the clinical in clinical research, and I'm going to show them in the next slide, and that's something to keep in mind as the program evolves. But I think an important consideration should be given to a new position that I call Associate Director for Industry Interface and Commercial Relations. This is something that will facilitate translational research. It will organize the interactions with the private industry, which is very important these days, both for funding of programs, but also for bringing things to clinical trials. Now, also the national, there are changes in the way NCI have used the national networks, and maybe we did that at Northwestern. Recently, we created a network oversight committee to organize everything, the RTOG, the GOG, and so on. Now, in terms of initiatives, there should be obviously an effort to increase investigator-initiated studies. There may be some areas like thoracic oncology that if someone strengthens and develops further could lead to new SPOR grants. And of course, there are many pharmaceutical master agreements here, but they could be enhanced further. For the faculty, I think there is, it will always help, and it will help a new emerging faculty if they have a formalized mentorship for junior clinical faculty, and I'm gonna show it in the next couple of slides. And as I mentioned before, I think developing a couple of institutes that will facilitate translational research could help significantly. So here are the clinical sciences programs of the Cancer Center. They are all very strong. I mean, the prostate oncology program here is exceptionally strong. I think it's the best program in the country. And the breast oncology program is very strong, the head and neck oncology, the pancreatic cancer program, the GI oncology and pancreatic cancer, and the heme malignancy. These are all very strong programs. There are also many developing programs in the cancer center here, and that I have listed, and some of them, if they were to emerge to develop, as we call them, in, programs for the core grant, they should be, you know, one has to see which ones they will be. I don't have the information to know that, but I assume that some of them will become full developed programs in the next round of the renewal of the core grant. So what I was talking before about decreasing the time to accrual to clinical trials, I know you cannot read this slide, it doesn't really matter. These are the steps that it takes to prepare a protocol submission. And it is really remarkable how many steps there are. There are more than 70, there were more than 70 steps at Northwestern, believe it or not. Now we have decreased it to around 50. And that has led to a dramatic decrease in protocol submission time. So this is something to keep in mind for this issue. Again, the industry relationships, I think their interactions with industry, I think they are very important. And formalizing these interactions by creating an associate director position, that's I think is a relatively novel thought. I don't, we don't have it at Northwestern, and I don't think many cancer centers have something like this, but I think this is something that is needed for these days and the way funding for research will continue. I mentioned before about faculty mentorship because this really helps, you know, helps developing clinical research as well. And I think a way to do it for junior physicians, clinical researchers, will be to create a mentoring committee that will have a mentor in the clinical area of interest. For instance, if that's prostate cancer, it could be a medical oncology faculty, it could be a senior prostate oncologist, but it should also have a co-mentor from a different area, like a surgical oncologist who also works in prostate cancer, and a third mentor who advises on career and strategy. I think this is important because trying to grow as a clinical investigator is not an easy thing these days, and having people advising you with different views and different points of view will help and optimize this development. Now, the two new institutes that I mentioned, and by institute, I have to clarify that I'm talking about something within the cancer center. I'm not talking about a separate financial structure altogether or anything like that, but something that could create new leadership positions and new opportunities for philanthropy. People want to give, you know, when they're gonna fund a program, they like to name a new institute and have the opportunity to support something they perceive as substantial. So one institute could be a developmental therapeutics institute focusing in developing developmental therapeutics here. This will clearly help investigator-initiated trials and clinical research. It could be combined with a developmental therapeutics fellowship. There are many people who want to do this in oncology. And this institute will also help with expanding pharmaceutical master agreements. It should, you know, have clinical operations within medicine, within HemOnc, and work very closely with the division of HemOnc. But it will have a different angle. You know, it will be developmental therapeutics, starting from phase one all the way to later phase studies. And that, of course, will interface with the Michigan, with the MI OncoSeq, and with the translational oncology program that exists here. Another possibility, the way oncology is moving and the way things are happening in cancer research these days, there is a major promise for human immunotherapy again. It's a very important field. And there is a strong immunology program here in basic science. So one could consider developing an immunotherapy institute that would complement this developmental therapeutics institute. And that, of course, that institute will have translational efforts focused on immunotherapy, but it could benefit substantially by the MI OncoSeq, by the availability of next-generation sequencing here, bring completely new different questions up and help to the developing new programs. This will interact with the Translational Oncology Program and the Translational Research Center, and it will also interact with the programs in the Cancer Center, the heme malignancies, and the immunology program. And there is also an immunologic monitoring core in the Cancer Center that could, so there are many pieces of that already here that will work together. I'm going to move to population sciences now. That is obviously an extremely important area for cancer centers and where there are major strengths here. The two programs in the cancer center here are biomedical prevention and socio-behavioral. They were both reviewed very well during the last renewal. And again, strengthening this area, there are some opportunities here. I believe that some of the programs that could, there could be some expansion in some areas that could help potential spores here in the future. For instance, leukemia and lung cancer, if someone was aiming to develop new spores, could also combine it with efforts in epidemiology or prevention, recruiting faculty there, and strengthening the head and neck spore. Now, this, there are also some other great things here. There is the School of Public Health, which is very highly ranked, and there is the Institute for Health Policy and Innovation, and the Ross School of Business, and someone could work with them on potential joint recruits or expanding the program of economics of cancer, which is a very important issue these days with all the challenges in reimbursement and so on. And finally, this I have put up there a survivorship institute, which goes again to the same concept, creating a new strike, new opportunities for leadership, philanthropy, new recruits, retention of faculty, and again, focusing on cancer survivorship care and research programs will be the primary goal of this, and supportive oncology. This is becoming part of integrated of clinical care these days. In our place, we have on EPIC, we have right now, we enter survivorship questionnaires in our electronic medical records. This should become pretty routine. And again, there should be, this institute could facilitate research and translational platforms, and it could interact with the population study center that exists here at the university. Now, other research issues, there are several cores here which are exceptionally strong, all of them. But if someone were to, and again, I don't have all the information, but I was thinking that if someone wants to strengthen more translational research, could think of developing a group of translational cores, as I call them, that will facilitate exactly that. So there could be possibilities for developing cores in the next core grant for a high throughput analysis core that will screen compounds that investigators can use, a synthetic chemistry core. There is a strong chemistry program here that could could help with developing new compounds, synthesizing compounds, doing virtual screening, and things, again, to bring new compounds that could be used clinically, and what I call a developmental therapeutic score. And that's something we have at Northwest, and we did it there, and is one of our most popular cores. That's a core where they develop animal models for different cancers that people that don't have access to these models can use to test a compound. And again, in my lab, we do a lot of work with animal models, but I also use this core. Like right now, we're working on a brain spore. So, and that core has an orthotopic brain cancer model, and we can test some combinations and compounds here. And this cork will also help bring to the next to developing a drug towards a clinical trial beyond that and fit to the CRO. So I think this is something that one could consider. And again, this will fit well with developmental therapeutics in serum that I mentioned before. And of course, if the course keep expanding, in some places they consider a position of associate director for course, and that gives the ability to integrate other people in the leadership and focus and engage on the course. Now, there are several sports here in Michigan. The place has been remarkably successful, and there are four sports and a major center for health communications. There are opportunities for new sports. Leukemia could be another area. Bladder cancer could be another one. And if some were to develop programs like thoracic, there could be more in the future. And of course, facilitating P01s, U01s, and U54s should be a major goal of the cancer center. Now, regarding the cancer institutes that I mentioned before, so I suggested three institutes, but down the road, you know, in the next few years, one could foresee taking a similar approach in other areas as well, and, you know, developing other institutes that, again, could bring more philanthropy, create more leadership positions, and retention of faculty opportunities. But one of the most important things when someone thinks about developing research in a matrix cancer center is to have joint vision with departments. There should be full alignment. The cancer center director has to work very closely with the department chairs. And frankly, I think the only way to do this is to be good friends with them. It has to go beyond a professional relation. It has to be a friendship, you know, working with them as friends, having joint vision, because that's a cancer center in a matrix system cannot survive without working closely with the department chair. So that should be the priority of the next director. There are also opportunities for alliances with other comprehensive cancer centers, and that's something that the NCI is strongly considering and encouraging these days. Now, Michigan is part of the Big Ten Cancer Research Consortium, and that's something that should obviously continue and expand. And there may be other opportunities. There is this Orion network that was recently created between Ohio State and Moffitt, and that will give the ability for cancer research collaboration for big data. They have more than 100,000 patients already participating. I was talking to the director of Ohio, to Mike Alogiri recently, and he was telling me that other cancer centers now are approaching them, and they would be interested to working with more places. So that's something that will be happening more and more, and that should be in the thinking of this place as well. Clinical operations. Obviously, there is a great, you know, there are great clinical services here, but I think, and there is, you know, there should be a service line for cancer, and there is one, and that will be very important about how this line will evolve with the network expansion that should happen, and I think it will be important to have a clinical cancer center strategic plan. The leaders of the cancer center and the hospital and all the players develop a clinical cancer strategic plan that will have to do with space issues and how to expand the local network, which again, there are already great efforts ongoing here, but you know, it could expand to a much larger extent over the years, and also how to have a national network. This place has substantial depth in research and has the capability to market itself at the national level and have an international presence and alliances as well. And of course, to do that, the brand of the cancer center will be important. And one way I think will be great for this place is to take advantage of its strengths. And what are the strengths? The strengths is the great research And the major advances in precision medicine that started here with the MI OncoSeq. So branding the cancer center as a leading edge, molecularly driven and targeting cancer center could be something that will give it, define a brand that will be attractive and will lead to its expansion. There could be also innovative things in clinical care that start taking care. For instance, one could consider a pilot program in pathway-driven tumor clinics, site-agnostic tumor clinics. Of course, that cannot become the mainstream cancer care, but that will be important because it shows that the place is moving to the next level. MD Anderson is doing that right now, and I think Memorial is planning to do. So these are all things that will show that the place is different than other places and will define the brand. Having industry relationships, strategic alliances with the industry will be critical as these things evolve. Of course, bioinformatics and biostatistics are very important. And again, a fellowship and a training for physicians and scientists in precision medicine should be something important as well that could be tied to the developmental therapeutics fellowship and could help, redefining the curriculum for training of our clinical oncology fellows and scientists. So for the clinical operations, looking at the different areas for expansion, one is the local network. And again, it has to do with having the clinical brand, which should be around leading edge personalized medicine, and there should be a transparency of outcomes data so people know why they should come here. And of course, as it's already happened, there should be affiliated practices. And again, in some institutions, consider acquisitions and mergers and things like that, that could all help. But that should be, this is a very different place than anything else in Michigan in terms of capabilities. And should take full advantage of that. The place has sufficient depth that should have a significant national presence down the road, and the clinical brand of the cancer center should help for that. They should, again, using the personalized medicine experience. And the cancer center should encourage its member to participate in national organizations. There should be a central clinical trials communications network and things like telemedicine that we live in these days that can happen and help with that. And there should be down the road and more international presence. I think there should be maybe someone appointed as director of international relations. There are already interactions with China and other countries here at the university level, but there should be a global reach for international referrals. There should be interactions and communication between the cancer center and overseas cancer centers. Many cancer centers do this these days, and strategic alliances. And there could be even second opinions with telemedicine. The other day, I was approached in Chicago by a group from South America that they want to do second opinions by telemedicine. That could create another source of significant income for the cancer center. Education. I think I mentioned before that maybe one should consider appointing an associate director for education in the cancer center, enhancing, of course, T32 training grants, redefining the oncology curriculum to include precision medicine. And of course, education of community oncologists is very important. And the same is true for education of the public and the survivorship programs. So all these things should be consistent with the rest of the cancer center. And finally, philanthropy, which I think is obviously very important. There is a major opportunity here to name the cancer center. And that will be significant not only for the funding that I believe that the Cancer Center will receive, it's not just the monetary value, is that it will engage someone in the philanthropist who could drive other ones and could expand further. Developing new institutes is an attractive concept for philanthropy, I believe. And obviously, the donors are smart people, and they want to see philanthropy linked to innovative concepts. There should be transparency. There should be obviously funding raised by philanthropy. The donors should know how we use it, and optimally, there should be a process for review of how this is used in an open way. And of course, an important, that's not really exactly philanthropy, but promoting academic industry partnerships is another way to generate resources for cancer centers these days. I think it will be important to, as I mentioned before, to empower the program leaders and engage them in the process. And there should be various regular communication tools. There should be attempts to engage different communities and use social media as everybody else. So I'm gonna, I wanted to give an example of how partnering with the industry could be important. This is what happened recently in New York. There was a tri-institutional therapeutics discovery institute that was launched in October 2013 between Memorial Sloan Kettering, Rockefeller, Cornell, and Takeda. And that's focused on early target drug discovery. And there were $20 million philanthropic funds matched by Takeda. And they will conduct phase one studies. And and Takeda is an organization with $15 billion in global sales. So these are major opportunities, and someone has to be open to all these things and look for them, because it could make a big difference. I will finish by just trying to summarize some of the additional leadership positions that I thought may help the evolution of the place in the next phase. This is the structure of the leadership as it exists now. There is a director, deputy director, and deputy director for clinical services, and several associate directors in several areas. And this is all great and very well structured for a cancer center. In the next phase, one could consider expanding the leadership, engaging more people. If there is a need, one could consider an associate director for research facilities. I think it will be important to have an associate director for industry interface and education. And something that I didn't go into detail, but many cancer centers do that these days, is to have an associate director focusing on cancer disparities. We'll call it equity and minority health. And again, working to develop the international presence of the cancer center. So here is a summary of pretty much what I said. I think there are major opportunities for this cancer center. There is unlimited potential. And there are several strategic moves that I think one could do in different areas to bring it to the next level. And I'm going to stop here and take questions. Thank you. Yes.
Could you expand on your vision of what a Department of Cancer Biology would look like, what its scope be,
sure,
and its functions?
Right. I didn't want to go into all these details. That's why I didn't show a slide. But it could be a department focused that could have several thematic areas that could be adjusted according to the specific cancer center. Like, the new chair of the department of that department could define thematic areas, and maybe should work, together, obviously interact with the cancer center and the vision of the cancer center. But the idea is that it will allow to bring new groups of researchers that will work very closely with the cancer center for the for developing certain areas. This is something that is happening in many medical schools, and the importance there, I think, is that not only can strengthen the basic science, but there could be a close link with the cancer center and facilitate translation. It is really amazing, but when cancer center basic programs in the CCSG in the grant are reviewed, one major criticism that comes up frequently is that not enough translation. We're talking about basic science, not translational research. So a Department of Cancer Biology will not be clinical, it will be a basic science department, but that could help developing specific areas in the cancer center and facilitate translation as well. Exactly.
So obviously, there are healthcare systems that have done things in certain ways that we can learn from them. Is there any model you think that, instead of having to do the wheel, is there any model that is sort of similar to us but have done a better job in terms of outreaching and making themselves or the institution as a destination for healthcare?
Well, I don't want to get into specific models, because one could simply think of the Mayo Clinic experience. You know, the Mayo Clinic doesn't have the depth of Michigan. They don't have the science that exists here, but they have the marketing. They have gone out there, and they have done great things. And so there is no reason, in my opinion, that Michigan couldn't get to the same level. I mean, it's just going to a different, it was, the cancer center was evolving. To reach that level, it took so many years to reach that level of depth and substance. And now in the next phase, one could have the opportunity to take advantage of that for the clinical networks. So that's one obvious example, I think, because they are not a travel hub. They're not like other places and I think it's a good model.
Any further questions? Well, thank you very much.
It was a pleasure.